Okay, it says it's recording. All right, good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Katherine Bankole-Medina. I'm professor of history here at Coppin State University for the past 12 years. And I don't know why I'm here giving this presentation. And I'm gonna tell you what that means. I talked about some of the research that I was doing in August at University Day in August at the case meeting. And so to my surprise, I was asked to do this today in one of the concurrent slots, which really, you don't get a lot of faculty doing the kind of research I'm doing, speaking in this forum. So they've given me more time than I'm used to having around here. So I think we'll be able to make use of all the time. So if you'll bear with me, since I did give this presentation before, some of you have already heard it, so I'm gonna sort of skip over some things, but I'm gonna tell you exactly what's going on and why I'm here today. But before I start, I want to thank Provost Lewis and Seth Forrest, the Chair of Humanities, for their support. I also want to thank particularly former President Maria Thompson, because without her support for what I did, I would not have been able to do anything without her support. And she supported me before she left, and I didn't get a chance to even thank her before she left the area. I want to thank Dean Tacona, and who was very instrumental in all of this. And I want to thank my colleague, Dr. Abner Lewis Moon, who had to take over so many duties and responsibilities when I left, and did so with such grace and dignity, because it was just the two of us in the history program. And now we have Dr. Dupree Wilson here. If you haven't met Dr. Tisha Dupree Wilson, who's new to us, we're so excited to have her. And I want to thank Dr. Kokova Zalditu Selassie, who was very supportive in this fellowship that I received, and also Dean Ron Collins. At UMBC, I want to thank again President Freeman Hrabowski. He was incredibly supportive and instrumental. I can't say I haven't met a kinder person, actually. And it was so strange, because when I met him, he wanted to take photo. And I'm thinking, I'm not equipped for a photo today, but he's the president, you know? So, you know, you take a photo with the president. So if that photo crops up, just, you know, I was having a bad day. But he's a gracious man as well. I want to thank Dr. Jessica Berman, director of the Drescher Center, and the Drescher Center professional staff, Rachel Brubaker, Courtney Hobson, and Bernice Bolden. And my fellow, my faculty fellow colleagues, there were several there. One was Teresa Runstedler, a professor at American University. Also Rebecca Bowling, foremost denazification scholar in the world. She's a professor of history at UMBC. Also Michelle Scott, who is also a professor of history at UMBC, and Dawn Beeler, who is a professor of geography at UMBC. And so these were some of the people that I was able to interact with. I'm here because in academic year 2018-2019, I was awarded the Inclusion Imperative Faculty Fellowship from UMBC. And so as a result of that fellowship, I wasn't sure how the mechanics were going to play out, but they had to give me sabbatical with the fellowship. I was not looking for sabbatical. I was going to take leave or something like of that nature, but apparently it was something that had to be done. And so I was grateful to have the sabbatical leave award from Coppin State University. Okay, so this was a lifetime, this was, I consider, a once in a lifetime opportunity. And so I just got back in August, having been gone for a year and a half. I was very excited to get back to my students and to get back to seeing what was happening at Coppin State University, and because I know that we were into some changes taking place. So, and if you don't mind, if I can indulge you just for a moment, I just want to just tell you about the research that I did, and then if you have any questions, I would prefer you ask me questions, and I would also prefer to know what kind of research you're doing, because I think we need to have these types of forums. So, the purpose of my research was to present an historical account of the lives of African Americans within the volumes of the Maryland Medical Journal from 1877 to 1918. And my area, one of my main areas is the history of science, medicine, and technology, and particularly the history of medicine in the United States. So, and I'll talk about some of the other research that I've done with that. So I wrote up a proposal for this fellowship, and I was awarded the $50,000 based on the proposal. So I won't, you know, I'll let you ask me the questions instead of going into some of the more mundane details of the research proposal. So one of the things that I wanted to do with this research was to highlight the multiplicity of medical health disorders, disease prevalence, surgical procedures, and reports on post-mortem examinations in the 61 volumes of the Maryland Medical Journal from 1877 to 1918. So I covered the entire 40 years of the Maryland Medical Journal looking at the African-American experience. And I didn't know what I was going to find. I really didn't, and that's sort of that's the nature of research. This research also examines selected diseases such as syphilis. Dr. Poynter talked about the syphilis study, which I so appreciated you weaving the Tuskegee study into the IRB report. That was phenomenal. So I really appreciated that. And my research also deals with syphilis, smallpox, yellow fever, malaria, typhoid, tuberculosis, and hookworm, and surgical procedures, particularly eye operations, limb amputations, brain procedures, and those involving trepanation. So other medical issues included public health reports. In the medical journals, most medical journals, if they dealt with African Americans at all, they would compare white and black patients. So, but the Maryland Medical Journal did so consistently over that 40-year period. And also I looked at the development of African Americans in professional medicine through the building of hospitals and the training physicians for black doctors. And another major area of discussion was psychological disorders such as depression, imaginary illnesses, insanity, hallucination, and hysteria, and then cases reporting the medical care of black females, women, girls, and infants, and also women's issues dealing with menstruation and pregnancy. And then, of course, I found what I never thought I would find in the Maryland Medical Journal was a huge medical debate over the comparative prevalence of fibroids and cancerous tumors in black and white women. It was such an incredible discussion of doctors going back and forth about what that meant. And so all of this had to do with the proposal that I submitted to UMBC's Drescher Center for the Humanities. And this research had four phases. The first phase included research, reading, and data collection. So I actually started in 2014 collecting the data in the Maryland Medical Journals. Now, I don't know if this is funny or tragic. It could be a little bit of both. I went through the 40 years of the Maryland Medical Journal and pulled out every incidence of the African American experience. And then right when I submitted this proposal, they digitized the whole process that I worked on it from 2014 to 2017. And I would do it over the summers. And for those of us who do research, you know that because of our teaching load, we rarely have time to work on anything except over the summers and the holidays, perhaps. And so I spent every summer just sort of plugging away, and then as soon as I submitted a proposal, they digitized it. But I came up with a 340-page data set, and this data set represents the complete primary source document covering the African-American medical experience, the professional medical discourse of doctors, and other relevant clinical information in the 61 volumes of the Maryland Medical Journal. The second phase of this project involved further research into the periodical literature. So as a result of the fellowship, I was able to go to various libraries, archives, holdings, and the third phase of this project was observations of the appraised data set. And so this involved reading and writing. And I can tell you that I'd never been so so happy to get up in the morning and head to UMBC. And I would tell myself, because, you know, you talk to yourself, right? Or is it just me? Okay, you know, you talk to yourself. I know you do. I know you do. And I would get up in the morning and I would say to myself, this is all I have to do today is write. That's all I have to do is write. All I have to do today is read into the literature, to research. And I was so thrilled. And that's why I wanted, and I'm so glad that the provost did want me to do this, because I want to make sure that everybody at Coppin State University who does research and who wants to go after this type of fellowship gets the information and is able to do so. So that's what the phases of the research. Now, for those of you who don't know, because we don't talk about ourselves the way that we should as faculty, and I think that we should. One of the first works I published in this area is called Slavery in Medicine, Enslavement and Medical Practices in Antebellum Louisiana. And that's what I did first. And that's sort of my baby. That's where I came to love medical journals. I literally, if somebody who would sit around in the evening and read medical journals and think, this is just the most fabulous source of information available. There's so much in medical journals that tell you about American culture. I also published a critical inquiry of enslaved African women and the antebellum hospital experience. And there I looked at mostly enslaved African women who were admitted to the Truro Infirmary in New Orleans, Louisiana, and the kinds of treatments that they received. And that was published in the Journal of Black Studies. And what I found interesting about that is all the incidences of complications with pregnancies and just a host of illnesses that enslaved African women had to endure. I also published The Human Subhuman Issue, Notes on Physiological and Pseudoscientific Theories and Slave Medicine in Louisiana. And so here I discuss the issue of race, the issue of medical exploitation after the Civil War, and sort of incidents involving the medical spectacles. So African people considered to have oddities in terms of their physiology. And then I talked in that article about Otubinga, as well as what has come to be known as the Hottentot Venus. And, you know, most of you are familiar with that. And so I recently completed a paper on an historical account of the Southern Typhoid Fever Thesis and Diagnostic Racism in Antebellum Medical Journals. And this was an incredible article that I did. I'm still looking for a publisher for this particular article, because I traced the life of H.A. Ramsey, who was a Southern doctor whose area was typhoid, and how he came up with this typhoid fever thesis, where, of course, you know the racial outcome. Whenever Black people had a particular illness, it was attributed to them as a pathological condition of just being of African descent. So you couldn't just have a cough, you know. You couldn't just have the flu, you know. It had to be Negro flu, and there had to be something pathologically wrong with the race of people in order to contract that particular flu. So A.J. Ramsey was interesting, but I spent years working on this article because it was difficult to find information on A.J. Ramsey. So, and I'm smiling to myself because I drove my husband absolutely crazy trying to get to these places to find stuff. And some of you have met my husband and you know he's a very nice person, but he does have his limits. And so, but I also made him read the article when it was done. And then he was amazed because as it turned out, not only was Ramsey wrong in his conclusions about people of African descent, particularly enslaved African people, he was also a huckster. So I found out that he was a criminal, and he fled, and he fled criminal prosecution in Washington, D.C., never to be found again. And then when he did resurface, he purportedly committed suicide and rather than face charges. So these were some very interesting times. And so this was an article that I did just to give you a glimpse of this research, what this research is about. I had one more thing I wanted to add, and then I wanted to turn it over for questions, and also to find out the kind of research that you're doing and your research interests. So, you know, maybe you haven't mounted something, but you're thinking about it, or maybe you're working on something, but I just really want us to share, okay? So I'm just gonna go over some of the final things that I did as a faculty fellow at UMBC for 2018-2019. I'm gonna share some of the projects that I did, and then if you don't mind, I'm gonna turn it over to us. Well, first of all, I engaged in full-time research and reading and writing for the awarded project, African Americans as Specimens, Objects, and Agents, Race and Clinical Care in the Maryland Medical Journal, 1877 to 1918. And I did change the topic. That the work that I proposed was actually supposed to be an article. And as I got into this work, it became a book. So I'm now at about 250 pages. And I'm very excited to continue to work on it beginning June 16th, 2020. I also delivered presentations on behalf of the Drescher Center for the Humanities at UMBC. I produced the book-length manuscript of the revised project, and I now call it The Gaze of Medical Racism and the African-American Experience in Maryland. And I developed a proposal for academic publishers. I'm still working on the proposal too. I edited a work in progress, a manuscript. I've been working on this Fannie Jackson Coppin manuscript to teach my people a humanities introduction to the life and legacy of Fannie Jackson Coppin. So it includes her main work. And so I'm still working on that, but I was able to really work on it during the fellowship. I completed two additional scholarly manuscripts that I had been working on. One is called Chair at the Table, a real world discourse on intellectual identity, thought leadership, and the Black woman academic chair. And so this was a work where I was asked to talk about my experience as a department chair over the years. And so I was able to complete that. Also, I did a chapter for a book project, Africana Womanism, and the work that I did is an historical account of Ida B. Wells Barnett, anti-lynching texts, and Kawaita Womanism. And so I'm so excited about that piece. That was a departure. Now, unfortunately, the editor who contracted this piece from me and several others died unexpectedly. And so they didn't have anybody to take up the mantle for this. So I'm going to see if I can help out a little bit, but I'm so proud of that piece as well. I also developed a podcast proposal for Women and World History and Aging for American Public Radio, and another proposal for the 2020 Berkshire Conference on the History of Women, Genders, and Sexuality in Baltimore, Maryland, called Racial Epistemology and the Medical Sexualization of Black Women and Girls in Progressive Era Maryland. Now, I'm excited about that one too. I created an outline for a social media endeavor, the ASHE Project, Black Women in the History of Science, Medicine, and Technology. And you know, the one thing that I learned, and you know, my daughter told me this, and it doesn't cease to be any less true, that, you know, I love developing media projects, digital projects, but you know, it's a full-time job to run that stuff. Whether you're talking about a web page or whether you're talking about your Twitter feed or even if you're doing professionally on Facebook, you have to have staff. So that's something to keep in mind. I drafted two new history courses to be taught at Coppin State University, History of African-American Women and Reproductive Health in the United States. And that's a working title, and I need to go over this with Dr. Lewis Moon, who is our coordinator for the history program. But she was very supportive of this idea. And the second course was a history of medicine in Maryland, because I think it's time to teach that now. I produced a short video clip, An Ideology of Kindness, for the ASHE University in Bermuda. And then I also completed a certificate in nutrition and wellness from the Institute of Integrative Nutrition in New York. So what I want to say to you is that with this fellowship in which I was awarded sabbatical, I made the most out of it. I did everything I could possibly do under the sun. If it existed, I tried to do it. I tried to fit it all into that period of time. So with that, I would like to turn it over to questions. If you have questions about the Drescher Center, about the fellowship, about that experience, about my research, or you just want to talk about what you're doing, I would love to have that and love to hear that. And just thank you for your time and attention, and give me good reviews. Thank you. That's what they say on Twitter.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the differences you found in the illnesses that you looked at between the black and the white kids?
Yes. It really depends on what we're talking about. In the Maryland Medical Journal, they used to do a lot on publish a lot of data on disease prevalence in the community, and they mostly focused on Washington D.C. and the Baltimore area. Even back then, Baltimore was what do you call it, suburb of Washington D.C. and almost vice versa. And so they would publish information on disease frequency between blacks and whites. So if there was a measles outbreak, say for example in 1898, if there was a measles outbreak in the area, they would list how many black people got measles in the month of May, how many white people got measles in the month of May. And sometimes they would break it down into a particular area, but most of the time it was the Baltimore, Washington, D.C. corridor. So I found that fascinating because it was consistent. It wasn't that they did it once in a while. They did it consistently. Almost in every single issue of the Maryland Medical Journal, there was some type of disease prevalence reporting that they would do. And I thought that was absolutely fascinating. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Parisa. I work part-time at the fitness center, and I'm also in grad school for nutrition and herbal medicine. I plan on being
awesome.
A naturopathic doctor.
Awesome.
Right now I'm working on a project where we have to pick a disease or disorder. Have you found in your research anything that's very prevalent in African Americans at a higher rate than any other race? I know fibroids is one, but is there anything else that...
I don't want to sound flip, but you could almost take your pick. Hypertension is a major one. Hypertension is a top one, as well as heart disease. And so I think you can focus. Those are two of the big ones, sort of the big ones. And so you could focus on that to look at as well, especially in neuropathy, because you're going to be seeing clients in that profession, and you're going to be seeing clients who may have a background in hypertension, and you may need to talk to them about nutritional issues with reference to that. So that's what I'm thinking. That's awesome. Yeah.
What about diabetes? Was that one of the,
Yeah, diabetes wasn't, in terms of this research, diabetes wasn't on the scene yet. It wasn't understood the way that we understand it now. But there were so many other illnesses that they cited for African Americans. And as I mentioned before, malaria, yellow fever, tuberculosis, and typhoid fever were the main ones. Yeah, yeah. So, yes, sir.
In your research, you indicated that you found that whites often are particularized or labeled our diseases as. So, what do you think is the foundation for that? What is causing these people historically to take the position that what we have is othered? Do you think? Mm-hmm.
What
happens when, in addition, what happens when the whites have that same disease?
Oh, that piece is easy because that piece doesn't have to be explained. But as far as the other piece is concerned, yeah. The other piece is concerned. It's something that came out of enslavement, and also it was reproduced. The idea of black inferiority was reproduced after enslavement, because black people were not supposed to be free, and so when you overlay that onto disease, you also there's also competition, social competition. So where are black people going to live? Well, they're not going to live with us. What are black people going to eat? Well, they're not going to eat what we eat. Where are they going to work? Well, they're not going to work where we work. So there was this competition, there's social competition. And so what was interesting is that when they began to overlay these ideas onto black people, you have this circumstance. Well, if you can suggest that the black race is diseased, then that shuts down all conversation. We don't have to talk about equal rights. We don't have to talk about, you know, any of those things, because that's just what that is. And so in my research, black children were very often labeled as diseased. There was a condition at the time that plagued black children called rickets. Y'all heard of rickets? Yeah. Remember rickets?
Yeah.
And children would get incredibly, terribly deformed.
Right.
As a result of it, and one of the main deficiencies is a vitamin D deficiency. But the problem is when it happened to black children, because you have the deformity and the curvature and the sort of the image of this black child with this deformity, you're able to overlay all of this supremacist, white supremacist racial stuff on top of that. And then you can sort of maintain the status quo. And if the status quo is racism and white supremacy, well, it's easy to maintain if you do that. And that's what we saw. In my research, I also saw how black men were depicted in the medical journal. I almost want to say, oh my God, I could describe it to you, but you wouldn't believe it unless you sat down and read one of these. Black men as well as women were stripped naked. And one of the things that they would do is they would exhibit them to other doctors. They didn't have to get permission from the black patients. They just sort of did it. And so, but what I found with black men was they were very concerned about the black male physique and would always make comments about black males. And the number one comment that they made about black males in the medical journals, particularly in the clinical reports, were that they were robust. That was the word they always use with black males. They're robust. But think about that. That distinguishes the black male physique from any other physique, you know. And so it's those types of things that show up in the medical journals.
You said robust. I've seen evidence, too, of discussions about black male genitalia.
Oh,
yeah, it's going to be, you know, male members.
Yeah.
The whole idea was to create this notion that somehow what women you don't want to be involved with these animals.
Oh yeah, and it and no
that was
yeah
conversation.
Yeah, and it was part of the conversation among doctors in the medical journal. They were very curious. They were very curious about the anatomics of black people. And in the Maryland Medical Journal, I can tell you that from 1877, when you move forward, you know, you see technology start to take over. So when we have the introduction of photography, photographs start to appear in the Maryland Medical Journal. And I can tell you, before you pick up a volume, before you find a PDF of a volume, that they took photographs of naked black men, full frontal, you know, which is something that they never did with other patients. And I know, because I combed through that thing from 2014 to 2017, and they didn't do that with other patients. Now, that doesn't mean that they didn't exhibit white patients, because they did. But the exhibition of black patients was very, very different. And also the discussion of black patients, especially black patients' skin color. We often talk about how black people have discussions about skin color, but what I found fascinating was that the doctors, white doctors in this Baltimore-Washington corridor, talked extensively about skin color. So when a black patient came in, they understood that patient to be black, but they also understood that patient to be mulatto, and they would say so. And then they would overlay some ideas about that. So if a black patient came in and they thought that they were mulatto, they would say stuff, something like, I attended a bright, you know, meaning intelligent, mulatto patient today. You know, but they never did that with the other patients who they would not classify as that. They were particularly interested in black females who were considered mulattoes, because they would describe how they looked as, you know, as appealing to them. Now, these are white doctors. This is not black people talking, having this discourse. And so I found that fascinating, but it's right there in the Maryland Medical Journal. It's all there. It's all there. It's incredibly fascinating. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. Did your research reveal disparate treatment in terms of how black patients are spoken to, or their pain not being taken seriously, if you know what I mean?
Like, yes.
You go in with the, I mean, even today, go in with, oh, this hurts. Oh, no, you'll be fine.
Yes.
Did your research reveal that?
Yes, it revealed that, and it confirmed that. Some of our contemporary scholars, particularly the black women who are doing work in the history of medicine and slavery in medicine, have talked about that. But it's there in the Maryland Medical Journal. They really truly believed, and they said so, that they believed that black patients did not experience pain in the same way as white patients. And so when we talk about, the medical community talks about that today, but that goes back a long time ago. And so they would not give them the same dosage of medicine. And then I came across something that was particularly startling, and I don't know how to handle it, because this is a research that I really want to work on, but as you know, with our teaching schedule, you know, it's very difficult. But I came across some of the first instances where they were giving black patients heroin and cocaine. And that wasn't unusual. I mean, they would give patients heroin and cocaine, and you know, cocaine was the main product in Coca-Cola. And they, you know, gave it to people, and people drank it. And but Coca-Cola, from the very beginning, was a medicinal product. It wasn't, you know, we think of it as a soft drink today, but in those days, Coca-Cola was part of that, the pharmaceutical, commercial pharmaceutical industry. And so I ran across the incidences in the Maryland Medical Journal where they were giving black people heroin and cocaine. And then by the time we get to World War I, they are starting to discuss how black people are becoming addicted to heroin and cocaine, and that this is such a problem because these people are pathological. You know, they don't, you know, so the discourse is very, very racial. It's very real. And I just thought that was absolutely amazing. So I'm still working with that piece because it's there. Because I remember in the 70s and the 80s when heroin was a big problem in some of the major communities, and people would say, well, you know, those are just personal failings. People just don't know how to get themselves together and lift themselves up and do right and be right. And then, of course, today with the opioid crisis, all of that discussion is out the window. Nobody is having the discussion about personal, ethical, or moral responsibility. It's about how can we help now the white community who is suffering from opioid addictions. So, but the idea that blacks were immune to pain. Right. But there was also another piece, the idea that black women couldn't get cancer. For some reason,
I wish that were true.
Cancer, yeah, you and me both. But for some reason, when it came to ovarian cancer, they believed that that was the domain of white women. Black women only got fibroid tumors. They only got fibrous tumors that were benign. But white women actually got cancer. And so here's the interesting, so I delved deeper into it, and this was a full-blown debate in the Maryland Medical Journal. Doctors are going back and forth about this.
I think they're doing guesswork.
Yeah, guess what? The person who pointed it out and said, I can tell you what's wrong, I can tell you what's going on here, was one of the few black doctors in Maryland. And he had, for a short period of time, they allowed him to be a part of the medical society in which these things were discussed. And he said that, first of all, you don't have enough cases. You're not reviewing enough cases to make those claims. And they made those claims vigorously. But so he exposed that, I call it the great fibroid tumor debate in my book, because he exposed them for basically their research fraud, but how they, in a very pedestrian way, contributed to that thinking. Because he said it was a problem. He said, because black women won't get the kind of care that they need if you continue to insist that they don't suffer from the same types of illnesses as their white female counterparts do. And so that's another example of what you're talking about, but it's right there in the pages of the Maryland Medical Journal. And I'm sure at the pace that I'm going, somebody will actually do this work and get it out before I do. And I hope they do. But Whitfield Winsey was the Baltimore doctor who exposed it. And I'm not kidding you. Not long after that, he wasn't featured in the medical society reports anymore. He just disappeared. They didn't really allow black doctors to be a part of it, but Whitfield Winsey was very fair. And it was believed that he could pass for white. And Whitfield Winsey went and told people that his wife was white. So I think one of the things that happened with Winsey was that the doctors invited him to be a part of their medical society, because that's where things get done. And they thought he was white. And then as you read further into the journal, it's very clear that not only is he black, but they're uncomfortable with it and they don't want him in there because, you know, the American Medical Association barred black people, black doctors for a long, long time, and actually was founded actually on the exclusion of black doctors. And the major case that dealt with that was the Washington, D.C. Medical Society. And they had to take it all the way up to the AMA. And the AMA said, no, don't worry about it. You know, if you don't want black doctors in the medical society, you don't have to have them. And so that's like right at the founding of the American Medical Association, which caused the American Medical Association to apologize to black people. I don't know if you remember this. They apologized to black people, what, a few years ago, because of how they were founded on racist premises. On premises, yeah. So yeah, it's a really intriguing kind of thing. But Whitfield Winsey is interesting. He really served the Baltimore community. He really did. And he really served. He served black patients as best he could, and I think he did an outstanding job. So,
I have a silly question.
Let's have all questions. Let's have all questions.
As you were engaged in your research in this area, was there anything that you found that caused your jaw to drop?
Wow, that's a great question. Yes, there is. All of it was just amazing to me, but there were a few things. The first thing was that black girls as children were depicted as promiscuous women.
Oh.
And I have a chapter.
As children?
Yeah, as children, by the doctors.
Wow.
by the doctors. They were very often depicted as promiscuous women, and these are Black girls. And so that's a discussion we have today as well.
So white men could rape them.
Because, right, unrapeable.
Yeah, right.
Right. The other thing that was really jaw-dropping for me was the medical criminalization and incarceration of Blacks. So we talk about that today. We don't have medical facilities to really house people to help them move forward from their issues. We just throw them in jail. But it was prevalent during this time too, between 1877 and 1918. It was very prevalent. And so my jaw dropped because I found all of this data on young Black people being committed to almshouses and insane asylums during this time, and for petty crimes. So if it was a Black child who stole a piece of bread, he could be taken to an almshouse, which was a poor house where they housed just about anybody, but particularly people who had psychological disorders. And the one case that really, really was disturbing was this 4-year-old Black boy who purportedly stole a shoe, and they literally took him to prison. They put him in prison. They put a 4-year-old Black boy in prison. And there was one white, I'll get her name in a minute. There was one white female muckraker reporter who, you know, just sort of reported on it. It didn't cause his release, but she, you know, she shed light on this particular issue. So that Black children who were orphaned, Black children who came from very dire straits, were often criminalized by the medical community and incarcerated, just put in prison, put in jails. So that was really jaw-dropping for me, because I had been reading these journals for a long time, and I'd never seen a child that age being subjected to that. Yeah, that was a little much. That was a little much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's incredible. So did we use up all our time?
Almost.
So what are you doing? What research are you doing? What are you guys working on?
Do you have a question about the little boy who was...
Oh, sure.
How did they justify that decision? It's a 4-year-old child.
There was no need to justify it. He was Black. Yeah. He was Black and he had committed a crime. I mean, literally, that was their reasoning. Yes, it does. I mean, you can see sort of the antecedents. Mm-hmm. You can see the antecedents of it. So it's not new. Yes, ma'am.
One thing, did you come? Now I've heard this. I've actually heard people tell me this. Women that back in the day, did you come across any of your research when women who were in labor? They said that Black women, they would in the hospital, they would actually just take them and put them in a bed, strap them, some of them, to a bed, and put them in a dark room and leave them there.
Oh yeah.
And you know, until, and sometimes a lot of them, you know, when they were to the point of giving birth, because they were pushing against, you know, and maybe they hadn't fully dilated, that they actually bled out because they would hemorrhage.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you said it better than I could, because the hospitals were overcrowded. And so, as you know, the facilities that would be offered to Black patients were triple overcrowded. And so they would stuff Black people in some far corner. But some of the major hospitals, like Johns Hopkins and some other hospitals, they would hire people, sometimes Blacks, but a lot of times it was whites, to serve as wards in these hospitals. But, you know, they really couldn't do much because they weren't doctors. But what I found was really troubling was I'm having trouble reconciling the mortality of Black patients, but particularly Black women patients who were in labor, where the mother and the child died, or where the child died, because still we're still dealing with a period where medicine is developing in the United States, and they were still, excuse me as I try to describe this delicately, they were still removing children with some very, very questionable medical techniques that would cause brain damage to the child. And so the doctors would argue about whether or not this technique for removing the child was something that they should or shouldn't do. But while they were arguing about it, doctors were still practicing it. And they were practicing it on Black women patients. So, but here's the thing. I also read the postmortem examinations. And let me tell you, there's nothing like literacy, because they always cleaned up their messes. The doctors would always, whenever a Black patient died and it was considered suspicious, or I would consider it suspicious, we would consider it suspicious today, they would have a complete autopsy explanation as to what happened, how it happened, what time it happened. And it just makes you wonder. It just makes you wonder, because a lot of children were born some very with deformities, if they were able to live at all, if they were able to live at all. So yeah.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, Professor.
Did you find any correlation between the funding and the differential diagnoses, for example, with women? The Black women and the white women who were diagnosed with cancer, ovarian cancer, and the Black women didn't have it. They had fibroids. So that funds were diverted to the ones diagnosed, and then the African American women perhaps died of cancer or more ill, such as in the Tuskegee experiment.
That's an excellent question, and there's a yes and no answer to that question. Yes, I did find sort of this correlation that I really wasn't looking for necessarily, where white women who were considered to have cancerous tumors were able to get better care. They were just able to get better care because they were allowed into some of the medical facilities that we have in the Baltimore area, whereas Black women were not allowed. Or they,
it was just the fibroids to go home.
Right, because it was just the fibroids. Now, beyond that, there's not much more just in terms of concrete evidence, but certainly you can make the case that the white women did get better care, and I would say more attentive care when you read the detailed reports. Some of these clinical reports, you know, could be anywhere from 3 or 4 pages to 25, 30 pages long. And so when you sit there and read those things, you know, you realize that while Black people were getting care in Baltimore, they were also being used as subjects, as guinea pigs, if you will, as subjects, you know. And they were supposed to be grateful that they even got care.
So,
right. Right. And black people didn't have a lot of money, so to pay for care. And even if they had the money, there was no guarantee they would get care. And I'm just going to say amen about that. Okay. From a personal experience. So yeah, it's an absolutely incredible 40 years of the Maryland Medical Journal, where we can actually chart the trajectory of Black life and see how Black people are depicted in some very specific ways that move us forward in time to where we are now. So.
How did you recover from some of the shocks?
Honestly, I'm gonna tell you, when I did the book Slavery in Medicine, I went into the records of the Truro Infirmary in New Orleans, Louisiana. And so, and I covered 5 years of the admission book, the hospital admission book, and there were a lot of broken bones in that record, and these were all slaves. These were all slaves. Very few of them were free people, free black people. And one of the things that happened, blessing, was that I kept getting this pain in my arm. And I couldn't figure out why I was getting this pain. And I was reading all of these broken bones that they were using in the arm because, you know, black people were laboring. And so finally it occurred to me, you know, because, you know, sometimes you have to live in rarefied air. You just, you know, living on earth can just be difficult sometimes. So I tried to reach into my higher self. And I said, why am I getting it? I said, you know why you're getting this pain in your arm. All of these people, all these, you know, they're broken bones. So once I understood that that's what was going on, so how I dealt with it, and this that experience shielded me when I look at this experience, because I understand that there's a long trajectory, you know, of black people having to deal with medical issues of care. And but also the beauty, also I'm including in this work, the beauty of this work is that I found incidences of black people who have agency, who take over their own care, and they establish their own medical practices. They build their own hospitals, their own training institutions. And black people, then you have, on the other hand, you have black people who say, I'm just going to start healing people. The neuropathic sister's gone, but black people say, I'm just going to start healing people. And so they put out their shingle. So, but what it means is that black people were doing it for themselves.
Right.
So that it kind of, that kind of balances it out as well. Because if you knew what was going on the eastern shore of Maryland, you have black people over there on the eastern shore of Maryland doing hoodoo and everything. And I don't mean in a negative way, but if, you know, but for people who study, you know, the history of science, medicine, technology, especially if you study hoodoo and voodoo and all this kind of stuff. I mean, I ran across it in all kinds of places. I didn't know on the Eastern Shore people were working it out.
That's right.
And there was this one guy on the Eastern Shore, and his name would come to me. But anyway, he was a doctor, you know, doctor this, doctor that, Dr. John. But he was actually seeing patients and diagnosing them with illnesses and curing them by using a photograph. He was using photographs to do it. I never heard of anything like that. And so it falls into the annals of folklore, you know, but it is very fascinating because it does show that black people had agency and they were doing things for themselves. And like I said, with the building of hospitals, black hospitals, especially black hospitals that were built in here, they no longer exist. But, you know, Providence, you know, was one. And so, you know, black people were working out these issues that were rooted in race. So thank you for your time and attention.